I will now give you an example of a problem that is contained in CoRP, but which is not known to be contained in P. So it's an example of a problem that we know how to solve in this randomized setting, but we do not know how to solve efficiently if we are not allowed to use randomization. The problem I will tell you about is polynomial equality. In polynomial equality, we are given two polynomial functions in multiple variables, and the question is whether those two polynomials are identical or not. So whether they are always the same no matter what values you plug in for the variables. I'm assuming here that the polynomials are encoded in some suitable way in the input. In particular, they're encoded just like we would write them down, so we can use brackets and powers and addition and multiplication and subtraction to write down a formula that expresses this polynomial. Your first reaction might be that this doesn't sound like a particularly difficult problem. We can just compare the terms in the two polynomials. But the problem is that you would need to multiply out the polynomials to be able to compare the different terms. And if we have a compact input representation, as I just said, we are allowed to use brackets and powers and so on, then multiplying this out might result in something that contains an exponential number of terms in the original input encoding size. For example, take a polynomial like x plus y to the power of 124 times z to the power of 67 minus x times y minus 3 times z to the power of 197. Now try to multiply this out. You probably don't really want to do that because you will get a lot of terms. So I can write this down very compactly, but once you multiply it out, the size of this thing really explodes. So you don't want to do that, and you cannot do this in polynomial time. So this will not be a quick procedure. So what other ways would there be to compare those two polynomials? It's not obvious anymore how to do this now. And in fact, this problem is not known to be in P. We can make some simple observation, though, that simplifies thinking about the problem at least a little bit. Rather than thinking about two polynomials and asking the question whether they are the same, we can think about a single polynomial and asking whether that polynomial is identically to zero, which means that the polynomial evaluates to zero no matter what values I plug in for the variables. Polynomial identity testing is really the same as polynomial equality, because if I want to find out whether two polynomials are the same, what I can do is I can simply subtract them from one another and check whether the result is equal to zero or not. Polynomial identity testing is also an interesting problem anyway, because it has surprising applications. For example, it can be used to come up with new algorithms for testing whether there is a perfect matching in a bipartite graph. I'm not getting into the details of this. I just wanted to quickly mention that polynomial identity testing really has interesting applications that might also be very surprising, because at first, polynomials don't seem to have much to do with graphs and matchings. But if you're clever, you can kind of find these connections and find these surprising applications. So polynomial identity testing is a really interesting problem. For simplicity, for the remainder, I will simplify this polynomial identity testing problem a little bit, and I will assume that our polynomial only has a single variable and that it's a polynomial over the real numbers. Those are not real restrictions. The entire thing works for multivariate polynomials over different fields, but it's easier to understand what's going on, and you will get the main ideas when we restrict ourselves to this specific scenario. So how would we find out whether a polynomial and a single variable over the reals is equal to zero or not? So one idea is that we could just plug in some values for the variable and test whether that polynomial is equal to 0 in those places. And that's exactly what we're going to do. What will help us is the fundamental theorem of algebra, which says that if you have a polynomial of degree d, then the number of roots of that polynomial is at most d. And in fact, counting multiplicities and considering complex roots, it's exactly d. But for our purposes, it's enough to know that there are at most d different values for the variable that would lead for this polynomial to be equal to 0, unless, of course, if the polynomial is equal to 0 everywhere. So we should respond yes in our algorithm. So again, if our given polynomial is not identically to 0, then it can be equal to 0 for at most d different values of x, if d is the degree of the polynomial. So one idea we could have is we simply test whether the polynomial is equal to 0 in d plus 1 many different locations. And if it is 0 in all of those locations, we know that the polynomial has to be 0 everywhere. There's only one problem with that particular approach, and that is the running time is not polynomial. Because we have to plug in d different values, well, d plus 1 different values for x, and evaluate the polynomial for all those different values. But the number d plus 1 is not polynomial in the input encoding size, because d is the degree of the polynomial, so it appears somewhere in the exponent maybe, but our input encoding allows us to write powers very compactly. It allows us to write something like x to the power of 100, where the number 100 would be encoded in binary form. And therefore, the number d, the value of d, could be much larger than the number of bits in our input. So if our algorithm evaluates the polynomial d plus 1 times for d plus 1 different values of x, then that will take exponential time, potentially. So this doesn't quite work. We cannot be quite as wasteful. We can only evaluate the polynomial in a few different places, not d plus 1 many. What is our escape from this? We use randomization. We don't know exactly what good values of x to test would be, but we don't care if we use randomization, we just pick random values of x. And we just need to make sure that we have enough many options to choose from. So say we pick x to be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, up to 2d. So it's any number between 1 and 2d, any integer in fact. And we pick that number at random. And then we just evaluate the polynomial in that random location for that random value of x. So if the polynomial is identically 0, what is the probability that it will evaluate to 0 at our randomly chosen x? The probability for that is equal to 1, because the polynomial will always evaluate to 0 no matter what you plug in. But if the polynomial is not identically to 0, what is the probability that it will evaluate to 0 anyway? At most 1/2, right? Because we know it can evaluate to 0 in at most d different locations, but we picked x as one value out of 2d many possible values, so at most half of them will make the polynomial to be not equal to 0. So at most half of the values we can choose from will make the polynomial not equal to 0, and therefore the probability that we happen to pick a value that makes it 0 can be at most 1/2. This is already the entire idea behind the algorithm. If the polynomial is identically to 0, we will detect this for sure because we pick a random value for x, we plug this in, we evaluate the polynomial, and it will report to be equal to 0. If the polynomial is not identically to 0, then at least half the values we pick x from at random will tell us so. So the error probability here is bounded by 1/2. it looks like we are already done, but we still have to be a little bit careful so that we can actually implement this basic idea to run in polynomial time. Firstly, we need to be able to pick a random integer between 1 and 2d. But if we think about it for a little bit, we realize that this can be done quite easily in polynomial time. We need log d bits to identify such a random integer, because we just encode that integer in binary. And because d has to be written somewhere in our input, it has to be a number that is encoded in binary as well. So our input must contain at least log d many bits. So the number of random bits we need here to generate is in the order of the size of the input, so this is all fine. The tricky part is that we need to evaluate the polynomial at this position x. And I will not get into the details here, but it suffices to say that if you do this naively and just plug that value into the polynomial and then calculate what the result is, this will potentially take exponential time. The reason is, imagine you have a polynomial that is of the form x to the power of 1000. And now I'm telling you, you should plug in the value 2 for x. Now, if you do this naively, you would actually compute x, which is now 2, to the power of 1000. Don't even think about how exactly you would do that computation. Just think about how you would write down the final answer of that computation. The final answer would be a very large number. Just writing that answer down would therefore take a long time. So forget about how the computation would work. Clearly it must take a long time, because just writing the answer down already takes a lot of time. And when I say a lot of time here, I really mean exponential time in the size of the input given our particular encoding. There's a fairly simple way to fix this, but I'm not going to explain this in much detail. Essentially, what you do is you just pick a sufficiently large random prime number p. And then, rather doing all your computations exactly, when you evaluate the polynomial, you're not doing so over the reals, but you're doing all your computations mod p. And then the numbers you're getting remain small, and you can use tricks like repeated squaring to do this computation quickly. Overall, we get a randomized procedure that will decide this polynomial identity problem. And if the polynomial is equal to zero everywhere, we will detect this for sure and give the correct answer. And if it's not equal everywhere, we will give the correct answer with a probability of at least 1/2. So polynomial identity is, as a problem, contained in this complexity class CoRP.